we're in a series, we're called blessed. We're calling blessed to be a blessing. In other words, when God blesses us in life, how many know that's great? Wow, it's a blessing, right? But there's also expectation and responsibility so that we will funnel some of those blessings on to people that are around us. And so today we're going to talk about how we can bless other people with our prayers. And I just want us to realize that kind of all of us are at different levels when it comes to prayer. Now, there have been dozens of times, and I mean literally dozens of times, when I've needed people to pray for me. And thankfully, people have always been there at those important points, and they've been praying for me, and I'm so appreciative of that. And I know I need to pray for others, and I do pray for others. I've prayed for most of you here today, but I'll also confess this, that even as a pastor, my life can get busy. I can get distracted, right? And I know that for some of you, it's so easy. You pray frequently. You pray consistently and for long periods of time. It's just like breathing for you. It's like singing for you. And we're all supposed to pray, but for some of us, it's harder, and for some of us, it's more difficult. It's kind of like sharing your faith, you know. We know everyone's supposed to share their faith to those who don't believe, right? But some people, it just comes so natural, and others struggle with that. And prayer's kind of like that. For some, it's natural. For some, it's hard work. But we're all supposed to live lives of prayer, right? Amen. So we're supposed to pray prayers that bless other people. And I love this verse. I'm going to read to you out of James chapter 5, verse 16. It's an encouraging verse. We've had an encouraging testimony. Now here's an encouraging verse. It says this: the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Now what that means is that it works. It has power. It has ability. It brings to pass that which is prayed. Amen. And so as we talk about prayer this morning, I really want to talk to you about four simple questions that will encourage us to pray more effectively, all right? And the first question is this: when I pray, is it all up to me or not? Now, sometimes when I think about prayer, I get this huge burden that kind of settles on me. Has everyone ever felt like that? It kind of almost weighs you down. Like I have to carry the whole thing in prayer. Has anybody ever felt that way? It's kind of like, well, if I don't pray right, you know, it's not going to happen. If I'm intense enough, well, eternity hangs in the balance. There's a story in the Bible that I know, and it's about a guy who was supposed to bang the arrows against the ground, and he only banged the arrows 3 times, and the prophet said, you should have done it several more times, and we would have had complete victory. And, you know, that comes into my mind, and it's like, how many know the enemy can play the word of God and play tricks on you? And you know, that's a trick of the devil to make you think that prayer is some heavy burden that you have to carry. Because when we go to God in prayer, what we are doing is we are connecting with the supreme God of the universe. Come on. How many of you know that prayer is all about God's power? It's about what God does when we pray. And sometimes we get in this mindset, if I just do it right, if I have the right words, if I'm fervent enough, if I'm sincere enough, if I pray long enough, then I'll be the one who controls this thing. Well, I want you to get this today. It's not about our power. Come on, do I have an amen? It's about His power. God's word makes that very clear. Actually, the Bible tells this about us, that we don't even know how to pray as we should. Right? So how can it be about us? Have you ever had any moments when you said, I just don't know what to pray. I don't even know how to pray about this thing. The Bible says we don't even know how to pray about every situation. The pastors and probably Billy Graham or some other great person of the faith had moments when he didn't really know how to pray. Romans 8:26 tells us this. It says, likewise, the Spirit also helps us in our weakness, because we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit Himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And so here's the deal: when our prayers bless others, it's not because of our power, it's because of God's power, right? And you don't want to know why that's important? Here's why. Because when our prayers are answered, guess who gets the credit? God gets the credit, right? If it were all about us being sincere enough, praying powerful enough, praying with just the right words, you know, whatever, we would get the credit. That's not the case. It's not about us. It's about Him. And that's the deal. In fact, Jesus even taught this in the book of John, chapter 11. And there's a great story about Jesus. He's visiting some friends of His, and Lazarus has died, and He's visiting Lazarus's sisters, and Lazarus has been in the grave for some time, and He goes to visit the grave, and everybody's crying. The sisters are crying. Even Jesus Himself is crying, and a big crowd is kind of gathered around, and Jesus says these words. He said, "Father, I know that You hear me when I pray. I know that You're hearing me right now, and I'm praying out loud so that the people will believe in me." And how many of you remember what happened? Right, He said, "Lazarus, come forth!" And man, here comes Lazarus bouncing out. Amen. That's a powerful, incredible story in the Bible, right? But if you continue reading the chapter, you'll find out that a lot of people believed because of the miracle that He did. All right, and so that's the point. And the point is that God gets the credit. God gets the glory. It's not about you. It's not even about the people you're praying for, my friend. It's about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the sovereign God of creation. Come on, give the Lord a big hand of praise today. Amen. So here's a point of personal application, all right? I think it will help you, all right? When you pray, you can relax, all right? Amen. You don't have to carry the whole thing. We work with the Lord. You can resign, in a sense, as God of the universe. You're not in charge anymore. Just leave it up to God. Put it in His hands. It's all about Him. It's all about His power. Amen. And now let me give you the second question today. When I pray, should I be formal or not? This is a question that many people, who are just beginning in prayer, ask one another. And it's surprising how many prayers in the Bible, they just says, like last week we were in Acts 12, and it just pretty much said, they all gathered together and they earnestly prayed. It doesn't tell us what they prayed, or it said, and so prayed. And it's probably a good thing that we don't know the exact words. Otherwise, people would think, well, wow, now I've got the code that I need, right? If I can say those same words with the same tone of voice in just the right protocol, and if I have enough formality in my praying, I'm going to get an answer. It's kind of like when you're eating dinner with a big dignitary, famous, rich person, I guess. You got to use the right fork. And I'm always confused if there's more than one fork anyway. Come on. I'm a one fork kind of guy. But anyway, a lot of people try to impress people when they pray. And maybe you've been called upon to pray at Thanksgiving or Christmas, New Year's. The whole family's there. Maybe you're the only Christian in the bunch, and someone says, "Hey, we need to pray." And guess what they do? They turn to you and they look at you, and you're like, "Oh Lord, really help me, Lord. Help me know what to say. I want to do this right." How many of you ever felt that kind of pressure to kind of be impressive with your prayers? Heard about a teenage boy who's going to have a blind date. All right. He's getting ready for the date. And so he goes to the pharmacy, to the druggist, and he says, "I'd like to buy 3 1-pound boxes of chocolate." And the druggist says to him, "Well, it's a lot cheaper if you just buy a 3-pound box." And the young man says, "Oh, no, I want 3 1-pound boxes of chocolate." And so the druggist says to him, "Well, why do you want that?" And he says, "Well, tonight I have this blind date. And when I go pick up the young lady, if she gets in the car and she sits over next to me in the car, rather than over by the door, I'm going to give her a box of chocolate." And he winked at the druggist and said, "You know what I mean?" And then he said, "When we get to the movie and after we eat our popcorn, when we're all settled in, I'm going to put my arm around her. And if she doesn't move away, I'm going to give her a second box of chocolate." And he winked again. He said, "Do you know what I mean?" And then when I take her home and I walk her to the door and I want a kiss goodnight, if she gives me a kiss goodnight, I'm going to give her that third box of chocolate." And he winked the third time at the druggist and he said, "Do you know what I mean?" Well, the young man bought the 3 boxes of chocolate. The druggist kind of just shrugged his shoulders. Well, the young man went to pick up the girl for the date, and he had to have dinner with the family first, right? And so the young lady's dad called upon the young man to pray. And I'm telling you, this young man prayed like no young man has ever prayed. I mean, he was calling on God. He blessed every single dish of food on the table. He prayed for everybody around the table by name. He was praying for missionaries, and he was making up names. He didn't even know the names of any missionaries, but he prayed and he prayed and he prayed, and they thought he'd never get done praying. I mean, he was really going after it. And so finally he got done praying, and after they ate the meal and the young lady and he were walking out to go on their date, the young lady was still, you know, kind of like shrugging her shoulders, wondering what was going on. And she says, "I didn't know you were so religious." And the young man said, "I didn't know your daddy was the druggist." You see, he wanted to be impressive. How many of you know that actually a lot of abuse has gone on in the name of praying? It's true. We try to be impressive with our prayers. We try to advance our own agenda by our prayers. I've heard people use prayers to gossip, you know. "Oh, Lord, be with Lori in her lust for George." And Lori and George are sitting right there. I'm like, really? Come on. And I've had people try to be so knowledgeable and so, you know, so scholarly. They pray like they're theologians, oh, great, supreme, eternal, omnipotent, omniscient beings that who art in the third heaven. And on they go, or they drop into King James Version. You know what I'm talking about. If you want to really impress God, let me tell you how to do it. Jesus taught us in the book of Matthew chapter 6, and I'm going to read this today out of the Message. I know it's a paraphrase, all right? We can understand that, but these aren't the actual words that Jesus said, but it kind of gives the meaning in a modern sense, all right? Let me read it to you out of Matthew chapter 6. Here's how you really impress God. "And when you come before God, don't turn that into a theatrical production either. All these people making a regular show out of their prayers, hoping for stardom. Do you think God sits in a box seat? Here is what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place so you won't be tempted to role play before God. Just be there as simply and as honestly as you can manage. The focus will shift from you to God, and you will be able to sense His grace. The world is full of so-called prayer warriors who are prayer ignorant. They're full of formulas and programs and advice, peddling techniques for getting what you want from God. Don't fall for that nonsense. This is your Father you're dealing with, and He knows better than you what you need." Come on, how many of you know that's what impresses God? Come on, give the Lord a big hand of praise today. So first, when you pray, you can relax. And second, when you pray, what you really need to do is be real. Tell your neighbor you can just be real with God. You don't have to put on any other kind of personality. Just be yourself. God knows who you are. He knows how you think. And just talk to Him like you would talk to anybody. And the third question is this, number 3.